Sarah, we have a real affinity to America and our hearts are breaking across Australia as we see these scenes, particularly the snowball effect that the riots are having and the looting and, you know, what started as a peaceful protest to honour this man has, you know, completely blown up and taken America over completely. And a lot of people here over the weekend, I've heard them say, lucky we live in Australia. And I quickly thought, well, it's not so lucky for some 420 families who have had loved ones die in custody since 1991 in Australia. And I highlight this, I need to say that I have utmost respect for police, I have utmost respect for authorities in general because they're keeping us safe and we see this through the pandemic. It's important, though, that we don't live under a cloud or we don't bury our heads in the sand and we're not ignorant. We need to be aware of the country that we live in. And it's not perfect. A lot of people tell you it's not perfect. And I just wanted to highlight a few cases recently that we've seen. We have two police officers in Australia currently who are charged with murder. One of them over the shooting death of Joyce Clark in Geraldton in WA. That was in September 2019. And this is Geraldton taking to the streets. Well, I think we'll get to the Geraldton shortly. But
These are live pictures that are coming in from Washington pictures. At the moment. The protests that are happening there.
And as people have been saying, it's peaceful protest by day. And then when night falls and the curfew falls, there are people sit out on the streets. This is Joyce Clark now in Geraldton. In September 2019, her family called police to help them as a last resort to help. She had just been, she had mental health issues. She had just been released from prison. She was known to police and authorities. Her family as a last resort called police to help. They shot her dead. There is an officer now charged with murder. And he was charged with murder after scenes like this in Geraldton. And they were peaceful protests for the main part. And then in November 19, we saw another shooting death in the Northern Territory at Yuendumu. A young man, a 19-year-old Kumanjay Walker, was shot dead by police. And that was a domestic incident that they were responding to. And there's a police officer that's been charged with the murder of Kumanjay Walker. And we can only just hope, you know, that justice will take its course. You can see the community there at Yuendumu, you know, just making their sentiments known.
So when you see these angry protests and people who are just so full of rage, Narelle, yep. I'm sure you can empathise and sympathise with them because you know what it's like for your people to be profiled and to be targeted, because it seems that's what seems to happen more to people. People of colour?
Well, it takes for coroners to give their recommendations for systemic things to change. And, you know, we've seen police commissioners come out and apologise to Aboriginal people for the treatment and for, you know, which stems from, you know, the days where they were enforcing government policies of assimilation. They were stealing, taking children from their families, you know, so that's where it all stems from. Aboriginal people have had a history of not trusting police, you know, so that's where that all comes from. It is changing, and it takes for coroners to recommend changes. And we have never seen, from what I've read, a police officer convicted of murder during an arrest or something in custody. So this is really rare to have two police officers in Australia being charged with murder. And I just wanted to finish off with something that's come to light. I've only read about this case over the weekend and I can't believe that he's not a household name. David Dungay, in Long Bay Jail in 2015, he was moved from one cell to another, from what I've read, for refusing to stop eating a packet of biscuits. And the coroner found there was no real reason for him to be moved from cell to cell. But the pictures that were played in the coroner's court are so harrowing. And it resonates from what we've seen in America, because 12 times he says, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. Yeah. And there are six prison officers on him, holding him down. And he's saying, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. And they're responding, well, if you can talk, you can breathe. Moments later, he goes limp. He died. And the coronial inquest found that none of those prison guards should be held criminally responsible. They weren't trained very well. They weren't malicious. They didn't intend to harm him, but they called for changes to their training regime. And it seems to be for the coroners to enforce these recommendations or to recommend the changes, but for actual police services themselves around the states to make sure they're adhered to, because it's all about saving lives. And, you know, we're commemorating Reconciliation Week this week. These are these really harrowing pictures of David Dungay at Long Bay Jail in 2015. And the coroner just released her recommendations late last year. His family can't watch what happened in America because memories just come flooding back of what happened to their loved one when he was meant to be, you know, looked after. I mean, people are in prison because they've done something bad. They're not bad people.
They don't deserve to die for that, though.
That is the punishment.
You look at George Floyd. Yeah. He didn't deserve to die for allegedly having a counterfeit note.
Yeah.
And if it was a white man who had been trying to pass off a counterfeit note at a store, would he have died on the street that
day? And there
are
countless other stories, which, you know, Tanya Day in Melbourne was drunk on a train. She'd passed out drunk on a train. She was taken to the lockup. There weren't adequate checks. She hit her head several times against a wall in the cell. She died. Mm. She was drunk on a train, you know, and that is not something to be locked up for. Mr. Ward in the goldfields of WA was pulled over for drink driving. He was a highly respected elder in his community. He was put in the back of a paddy wagon through 40-degree heat and driven 3 hours drink driving, mind you. It was 56 degrees in the back of that paddy wagon. He died. And there are no charges coming out of those, but there are recommendations. So all we can hope, and especially during Reconciliation Week, you know, we have the chance to respect one another and to treat each other not for the colour of their skin, but the way that you would want to be treated. And that's all we can hope for.